And now I couldn't be more excited, loud and clear here at TIFF. Oh my God. It's Richie O'Donnell, or how do you pronounce your name in Gaelic? I love that pronunciation.
Richard O'Donnell.
O'Donnell?
O'Donnell.
O'Donnell. It's the same O'Donnell. Richard O'Donnell in Gaelic. And the movie is The Pipe, and it's brilliant. Brilliant, brilliant, brilliant. I saw it yesterday. It's a doc. It acts on you, though, like a feature film, because you can become so engaged with the characters and the story. And what a story. Do you want to tell us what The Pipe is about? It's one of the best films here at TIFF. One of the best films of the year, in my opinion.
Well, it's the story of a small community. Shell Oil find gas off the west coast of Ireland, and they want to bring the high-pressure raw gas pipeline into a pristine, beautiful bay that's the fishing grounds.
Galway Bay, is that?
No, it's Broadhaven Bay. And it's a very...
beautiful.
It's surrounded by high cliffs and a lovely, lovely, soft, white beach. And behind it is a village of Rossport. So they want to bring the pipe in the beach, up through the farmland and into a refinery. But when people started asking questions of the government, why wasn't there any transparency in this? Why weren't our rights being followed? Why weren't we being consulted? They were ignored. And so Shell came trying to lay the pipeline without the consent of the landowners and the fishermen. So when people resisted, five of the farmers were put to jail indefinitely. And that started a whole train of events, which really caused huge division in the community and huge conflict against Shell. And then when Shell started trying to buy support, it set neighbour against neighbour. And we have... one of the fishermen, he's a crab fisherman called the Chief. He's a timber, a 45-foot timber boat.
Is and that the main character? Of
he
the,
would be the biggest character in it. There's three
the
characters.
Movie. Yeah,
yeah,
and
the fisherman.
You feel so deeply for these poor fishermen. And I don't particularly like crabs, you know, although I like to eat them. But I was never so happy when at a certain moment towards the end of the film we see a whole thing of crabs, sort of red and lively and happy looking crabs, and I'm going, oh thank goodness, because I can't tell you how beautifully this is photographed, and you've shot it too.
I would have shot most of it, yeah, about 95% of it, except for the aerial photography.
What kind of camera was it? It was gorgeous. I mean, I felt like it was a trip to Ireland as well.
Yeah, most of it is shot in a Sony Z1, which is HDV. And also we shoot on a JVC, also HDV. So, I mean, I would have shot most of it on the fly while doing the sound at the same time. But it's just, the scenery is so beautiful.
Yes, and you
and the background is so beautiful.
And the ocean and
the light, I mean, the light of the water is so gorgeous. The early mornings and sunsets. You know, you just can't go wrong. So from that point of view, it was very hard not to make it look nice. And the characters are so engaging that you're immediately drawn into them.
Yes, that's true. And you made the landscape, the sea, they all become characters too, and you're rooting for the sheep. I couldn't believe I was rooting for the sheep. And also for the beautiful, beautiful countryside. And yeah. and I hate Shell Oil now. I'll never buy anything from them. I mean, they just come in and they think they can just walk all over these farmers and fishermen. And it just, I'm still angry after seeing that film. Yeah. So anyway, you're also a camera person in Ireland, right? You're a newsman, yeah. Anyway.
Well, that's how I would have started it. That's how I would have got into it.
Yes,
I was
yes.
filming some.
I'm sorry, I'm talking too much, but you're used to that. Anyway, on the Stephen Holt Show, okay.
But I was covering it as a cameraman for news.
Okay.
And you know, I'd be shooting footage, and it would go to the news, and I'd be kind of reading about how the story was presented through the media and newspaper articles, and I thought people down in Mayo, where in Rossport, were being kind of misrepresented by the media. Their true story wasn't being told, and they were being represented as, you know, lunatics and people who were anti-development and who were just looking for a fight,
oh
which wasn't
God.
Actually
no.
the reason. These were people who just wanted their civil rights to be followed and who wanted this project to be done in an
land,
open,
they
transparent
wanted to farm.
Yeah,
they wanted to catch their crabs, it's their livelihood. They wanted to raise their children from their make a living.
They weren't against the gas per se, but they wanted to maintain their way of life as they had for generations and bring up their families
and
in a clean, safe
wow.
environment. And the oil company, with the help of the of our government, railroaded over their rights and just tried to plow this thing through. So they just shouted stop. And they were jailed for it, they were beaten for it. But
it's unbelievable. I mean, and the central character, the guy who had the fishing boat, who we spend most of the time with. I mean, I started, you know, meeting you up here at the Toronto Film Festival, which is where we are now creating all this buzz. You were, you know, I thought, well, you know, I knew you that you were a newsman, but you were on that boat. You turned into a fisherman with this movie. I mean, the photography, the sea photography, the boat, and your interaction with him, especially, and him being jailed, and that the shots of that horrible, big, crane-like thing that was going to make the
We were two weeks on the boat with him because we didn't know when the big shell boat was going to come. And now this thing is called the Solitaire. It's the world's largest pipeline vessel.
Yes.
It's the size of two football pitches. It's massive. So he had his crab pots along the seabed, and Shell wanted to lay their pipeline where his crab pots would be. So he wasn't moving. So he stayed out at sea for 2 weeks, not knowing if this thing was coming or not. So I just stayed out with him on the boat, and I'm not a good seaman.
Oh,
so
okay.
I mean,
you looked like
I was. No,
photography certainly was, Ricky. Yeah,
no.
Richie.
But I was actually pumped up on antihistamines to try and keep the seasickness away, because he has got a little boat, and it just rolls constantly over and back, and he smokes a lot. He smokes one cigarette after the next.
And what's his name? We should have his name.
Pat, the chief. O'Donnell.
Pat the Chief O'Donnell. Now,
yeah.
Is that a relation?
No relation at all. Just there's a lot of O'Donnells in Ireland.
Because this is Richie O'Donnell. It's a lot of O'Donnells, yes.
The reason they call him the Chief is because long before the gas came along, he was involved in a cave rescue.
Cave rescue? What did he do?
There was a family went boating, and they got washed into a cave. Now, when the lifeboat tried to rescue them, they weren't able to. They had to stay offshore because the swell was too high. But the chief brought his boat right into the cave, and working with the police, managed to get the people in the cave out of the cave. It was an amazing piece of seamanship. Now, the curious thing is that 10 years later, during a protest where the chief was involved in a protest where it was quite a scuffle, one of the policemen that he had rescued in the cave that day stood up in court and identified him.
Oh my God.
In the protest. As, you know, as a criminal, basically, trying to criminalize this guy. So it's very tragic the way, once upon a time,
horrible.
These people worked hand in hand, you know,
yeah.
Put their lives at stake, both the policeman and the chief, to rescue other people. And now they are kind of staring each other across a divide. It's been hugely tragic. The relationship between the police and the local community has just broken down completely.
So there you were a newsman covering this story, and then you met this guy, Mr. O'Donnell?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I've my uncle is a farmer in the area, so I would have known these people anyway long before. You know, I knew them to be normal, decent people. And it was because the media was being quite disingenuous in their coverage of the story. And the reason that was because the power of Shell through the media. Shell were very manipulative of the media in terms of buying up local journalists, in terms of bullying local newspapers and radio stations, and just in terms of their sheer size. So the story wasn't getting out, and that's what I took offense with, and that's why I decided to keep filming on my own bat. But I never thought it would take 4 years. I mean, I thought 6 months, we'll wrap it up, put it out, a half hour television. But the story just exploded in front of the camera.
How did it explode?
Well, I mean, you have the world's largest pipeline vessel comes in the bay.
Which you didn't expect, or you did expect, or you didn't know what was going to happen.
And even the people in the local community didn't know. I mean, they were never consulted. So everything that happened, you could never plan for. And this standoff between the fisherman, the crab fisherman, and the boat, the Solitaire, I mean, I never knew it was going to happen. I was just there all the time. So whatever happened, happened.